Welcome to the Writer's Rendezvous from the South Dakota Humanities Council.
Hi, I'm Carl Gerke from South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm here at the South Dakota Festival of Books 2013 at the Deadwood Mountain Grand, and my guest is Marcia Mitchell. She's written a couple of books about real-life stories about spies and with her late husband, Thomas Mitchell. One of them is The Spy Who Tried to Stop a War. Marcia, thanks so much for joining us here.
I'm very happy to be here, Carl.
Now, this book here that... The Spy Who Tried to Stop a War. This is about the Iraq War, involves the NSA, and this is a book, even though it came out, I think, what, 2008?
2008, that's
this,
right.
This is as relevant and current as pick up a newspaper today.
It's more so than one might imagine, given the fact that it came out in 2008, and that's because of Edward Snowden, Bradley Manning, the new information that's come out about NSA spying on us. There's great interest again in the story of Catherine Gunn, and some people are calling Catherine Gunn and this story as the precursor to Edward Snowden's revelations, because of course he focused on NSA and this story focuses on NSA secret surveillance.
Now this is a story that wasn't reported in here in the U.S., but it was big news in England.
It was big news around the world, Carl. The headlines in newspapers everywhere, except in the U.S., were major headlines, page one stories, usually with headlines like U.S. Dirty Tricks at the U.N., very critical of the U.S. I think in our research, I found one story in the U.S. that even discussed in at any length any information about this case was on page A17 in the Los Angeles Times, and that was perhaps two paragraphs way back in the newspaper. So the U.S. mainline media totally ignored this story.
Now this was the story about Catherine Gunn. This is leading up to the Iraq War at
right.
The UN. You can tell us a little bit about that.
She was a Secret Service officer in GCHQ, which is the British equivalent of the NSA. And one morning at her desk, she fired up her computer, and here was a message from the NSA to GCHQ asking the U.S. to join in an illegal spy operation against members of the U.N. Security Council, specifically six swing vote members who really held in their hands the possibility of passage of a special, a variation on a previous U.N. Security resolution, but a new resolution that would legitimize the war, the invasion of Iraq. And it was clear that the intent was to blackmail these six swing voters to encourage them to vote for, quote, U.S. policy. So Catherine realized what was going on, and she was 27 years old, idealistic. Interestingly, Snowden was 29 when he reached the same conclusion. But she saw, because of the content of the memorandum that she saw on her computer that morning, that they were not only going to wiretap and surveil the offices, but the personal lives of these six men, and the purpose being to persuade them to vote for a new resolution. The existing resolution, UN Security Council Resolution 1441, which is what justified the original Gulf War, didn't work in this case, because no one had invaded anyone. And it was patently illegal to go to war for a purpose that was other than self-defense or a just humanitarian cause. They didn't have a reason. So they needed to go to this method, they thought. And Catherine then went in, this happened on a Friday, and she thought about it over the weekend, and went in Monday morning and printed out a copy of the memo, and as she says, sent it off to the world. And for 3 weeks, nothing happened. And she was thinking, oh, I'm saved. This is wonderful. You know, she was terrified by this time. And then she went one Sunday morning to buy the newspaper, and it was all over the headlines in England. And by the next day, it was making headlines all over the world, except in the U.S. And she went into work on Monday, and everyone who had seen the memo was interrogated. And she denied it, that she had anything to do with it. But by Tuesday, she decided that she had to confess. And so she confessed to that. What happened as a result, in short order, the US-UK resolution for war was withdrawn because everyone was outraged. The Security Council members were furious that this had happened. So the resolution was withdrawn. Tony Blair then went to Lord Goldsmith about the legality issue. And Lord Goldsmith, who was the Attorney General of the UK, was not an international law expert. But Elizabeth Wilmhurst, who had been for 30 years the UK's senior international law expert. In fact, she was relied on by much of the world because of her background and experience. In any event, a 13-page opinion was written declaring that it was not legal. And that, in fact, or at least that it was questionable, and that, in fact, to go ahead with the invasion could amount to a war crime. Attorney General Goldsmith presented this, the opinion, which Elizabeth had written, and Tony Blair didn't like it and sent it back. And this happened right after Catherine's story was revealed. And Lord Goldsmith then wrote a one-page, nine-sentence opinion. He said, no problem, go ahead with the invasion. So that was one of the great lies. It's one of the great lies that this book discusses. And it was lie after lie that came upon that. It was so easy to blame the intelligence community later to say it was poor intelligence, but it was not. The right intelligence was there, but it was manipulated wrongfully.
The fact that this was not reported or underreported in the U.S., is that an indictment on journalism in the U.S., do you think?
Carl, that's very hard to answer. I asked a friend who is... who has several ABC television stations, and he's a great newsman, and we talked about that, and he said, you know, I wondered at the time how they could still do that. Who is they? He would not say who they was. You know, who were these decision makers who influenced the mainstream media? And is that possible? Did that happen? I don't know. For some reason, the U.S. press ignored this. Now, this book was named one of the best books in 2008 in the U.K. It was hardly noticed in this country. But because of Snowden now, there's this enormous resurgence of interest in Katherine Gunn and in this story. And I've been doing interviews around the country on this story. Two requests are a little frightening. They came from the Iranian news service that wanted me to speak about secret NSA surveillance. And I said, I don't think so. You know, I've been on the watch list before. I don't think I want to get back there.
Hey, you mentioned the NSA. Before Snowden, and this is something you write about in the book, you know, the NSA, that really, we really weren't paying that much attention to the NSA until
We were not. And they've been doing this for years. Not too long ago, it was revealed that they, you know, had spied on G8 and G20 meetings. It's amazing. I mean, it's been going on for years. But also, you know, we look back to our earlier book on the Judith Copeland story, and she was arrested at 27 years old. And her conviction for espionage was overturned because of, guess why? The government was secretly surveilling her and listening in on her telephone conversations with her attorney, even at the time of her trial. So the government secrets have been so fascinating, so interesting. And the secrecy that's inherent, I think, in any government leads to lies. The lies lead to the spies, because in order to protect the secrecy, we have to have spies who are working for us. And then, of course, there's spies who are working against us. We're spying on them, they're spying on us. And the big question everybody asks about this story is, was she right or wrong? And they ask about Snowden, was he right or wrong? Those are very difficult questions to answer. And is the NSA right in listening in on my conversations and tapping into my email, which I know they do? And especially after getting, a U.S. citizen getting calls from Iran asking me to talk to them, certainly I'm flagged. And the people around me are flagged. And recently, there was a report that something like 1 million people were flagged because of their connection that went back to someone, the first person around this, at the center of this web, had no connection with espionage, with terrorism, with anything. It was a mistake. But 1 million inquiries. Every person that had anything to do with that person, the target, that person, mail and conversations were tapped. Now then that went from that person's connections and so forth. They say it's only metadata that they're using, and metadata, of course, is the time, the place, the people, and the method of communication. Supposedly, not the content. And if you believe that, I have a lot to sell you, in the middle of the ocean. I don't believe it at all. But then I've had some experience with it in doing research over the years.
Well, Marcia Mitchell, thanks so much for joining us. I'm sorry, we're out of time.
Well, thank you for having me.
Writer's Rendezvous is a production of SDPB.